Thank you, Professor Joy, for introduction. Good morning, everyone. Am I audible? Fine, right? So in this talk, I will be talking about data markets for smart grid. This is one of our recent works. So the content of the presentation is, I think many of you may not be familiar with power systems. So we'll briefly talk about, give an overview of power systems. Then we'll talk about data in smart grids. And then we'll talk about data markets for smart grids. Now, power system is basically the infrastructure through which you utilize electricity, right? So if we look at the traditional power systems, so it starts from centralized generating stations, and then you have transmission lines through which it is brought to the loads, like in your houses or industrial customers, commercial customers. Okay. So this has been the traditional structure of electric power systems. Now, what is the characteristics of this system? So if we look at, so this is a picture of a whole Indian power grid up to 132 kV voltage. So here you can see that it's basically kind of a graph. Like people who are from computer science, you can relate it. It's kind of a graph which has nodes. Nodes are basically substations where you have loads. And also you have generating stations. Okay. Now, this is a huge interconnected system spread over large area. One interesting fact about this system is if any disturbance happens, any part of the network, it propagates at the speed of light. So if something is happening in Mizoram or Meghalaya, it can impact at Bangalore within the blink of an eye. So this is one interesting fact of this kind of interconnected system. And this is totally nonlinear system. So this is a nonlinear complex network. And another criteria here is it is governed by your network theory. So mostly load generation and load and generation, these two has to be balanced always. Otherwise, system may not work. So you may lose stability. And another interesting fact of this is equipments are costly. So, and all equipments are outside. It's more, all costly equipments are in the substations. So they are subject to faults. Okay. So we have to always ensure that we can protect these devices, the costly devices, against all faults. So now what happens if, so I just briefly told you about this infrastructure. Now what happens if things go wrong in this? If things go wrong in electricity, this infrastructure, what we see is blackouts. Like if you remember, we had blackouts in 2012 in the northern part of India, northern and eastern. And in this context, I would like to show you one small video, one important, very important blackout, which actually triggered the concept of smart grids. So it happened in 2003 in North America, this blackout happened. So I'll just play a small video. It will not take much time.
We are in the midst of what appears to be a colossal and history-making blackout.
People trapped in elevators and buildings, they have activated the emergency command center.
You're staggering, trying to take in as much information as you can.
Mayor Bloomberg's advice is to go straight home.
The subway system is down.
Ottawa is completely without power now.
The lightning-quick domino series of failures.
You gotta go to the bathroom and you can't even go nowhere.
50 million people are thought to have lost power.
In 2003, a massive blackout struck major areas of the U.S. and Canada and was perceived as a wake-up call for the nation.
We've got a real crisis in our grid, and this is why, despite being a superpower, we have a grid that is comparable to a third world country, and that's not right.
But have 10 years of planning and preparation left us better off today?
I don't think you can ever say with 100% confidence we won't have a blackout.
So this is the incident which actually triggered the smart grid concept. Prior to that, even though like US was very advanced, its electricity infrastructure was is not modernized. So after this blackout, they felt the need to modernize it. And then the concept of smart grid came into picture. So smart grid is basically nothing but a power system with better communication capability two ways, like from distribution side, what is happening that they can contact with the control centers. So that is mostly like smart grid is basically power system with better monitoring and control, which we can think about. So now this is like on the power systems, what we have is, so in smart grid, you basically have two-way communication channels. And in addition, now we are replacing all coal plants with solar and winds, right? So now we look at some of the facts about Indian power systems. So voltage levels are, you can see we have till 765 kV AC transmission system. And distribution, you have 6.611 kVs. So mostly traction runs at 25 kV AC. And we also have DC transmission, so mostly HVDC lines. We have plus minus 800 kV and plus minus 500 kV HVDC lines. And metros, in some places like Kolkata, Bangalore, it works on DC. Okay. So these are the two big HVDC lines in India. Like currently from Assam to Agra, we are planning to have 6,000 megawatt HVDC line. So now how this grid is operated, like I told you that blackouts are there, but they don't happen every day, right? So how it is managed? So every whole India is divided into few control areas, like northern grid, western grid, southern grid, eastern grid, and northeastern grid. And each area has a control center. So each control center looks at its own area and ensures that there is a load generation balance. So how the control center looks like? So this is actually a control center in Bangalore. So here you can see across the southern region from all EHB substation, the measurements comes and gets displayed on the screen. Now there will be people who are sitting in here and they will be looking at all these parameters. If something happens, then they take the necessary actions. Okay. So now, these control centers in India, we call them load dispatch centers. So we have NLDC, NRLDC. So this is National Load Dispatch Center. Under that, we have many regional load dispatch centers. So now, all these load dispatch centers receive measurements. So what are the measurements in smart grids? One traditional is SCADA. SCADA is basically reports. These are located at the substations. They usually report RMS values every few seconds. Phasor measurement unit is the recent introduction. So it comes with a GPS synchronized clock. So it reports around 25 to 50 samples per second. Disturbance recorders are devices which logs information whenever there is a fault, and it logs at the sampling rate less than 10 kilohertz. Then we have smart meters which reports every 5 minutes, 15 minutes, 30 minutes or 1 hour. Now due to these renewables, we also have weather sensors. So which sampling rate is 1 to 2 samples per second. So we can see that throughout the whole country, all these sensors are constantly generating data. So what is the volume of that data? So we just have an estimate for smart meters. So if you have a 1 million smart meter installed, and if it reports value, suppose every 15 minutes, then you have 2920 terabyte data for 1 year. And this is just the smart meter. There are many other equipment which I showed, like SCADA, PMUs, disturbance recorders. So all of them are generating huge data. So now the question is, So these data contain important information about the grid. Now the question is, what to do with this data and who can do? Currently what happens is these data mostly stay with the utilities who are generating the data. There is not much platform, exchange platform, to get this data so that people can utilize it. So, and also there is not much incentives to encourage better data management. For utilities, once the data come, they look at it, they take decisions. After that, they just store it. There is not much importance to them for that data once it becomes a history. So here what we propose is, we propose the concept of data market as a platform through which you can buy and sell data. So the concept is like you will have a platform, you can have n number of data markets, it can be online platform. So there you buyers and sellers will participate. So sellers will tell what is in the offer, buyer will look at the price, if they accept, if it is okay to them, they will buy it. Now what is the advantages of this data markets? So first of all is revenue for smart grid data. So this can be a business model for the utilities. So they can also earn additional revenue from selling the data. And also then it becomes an incentive for them to properly manage this data. And then this actually increases the data accessibility. Like whoever wants data, they just go to the market and buy it. It's a very transparent mechanism. Okay. Then this data often happens is like suppose a equipment manufacturer, currently when they are designing their product, they don't have access to the field measurements. So now through the data market, they can buy those measurements and they can optimize the design of their equipments. And also like it will be a great benefit to researchers. So this data market, what will be the products? So we have identified mostly three kinds of products. One is data products. These are basically the measurements, like power system elements, values, measurements for smart meters, SCADA, PMU, then standards on smart grid, energy market data, meteorological data. So this is falls under data products. Similarly, there can be also some ancillary products like data analysis tools. Like companies can develop data analysis tools and they can sell it through this data market. Similarly, consultancy service. Consultation services, like a company can provide consultation services using the data analysis tool which they may purchase from the market and use that using the data, they can come up with some reports or solutions. So who participates in these data markets? So first of all, data producers. Data producers are basically transmission distribution companies, system operators, then meteorological departments. Then another is application developers who can develop algorithms and software which can be used to utilize this data. And then you have service provider who basically provides consultancy service. Then you have data consumers who just use the data. And then you have owners of the smart grid. So depending on the number of seller or buyer, we can have like monopoly or oligopoly condition. Monopoly is like when you have just one seller for the data. So this condition may arise if for a particular application, you just need data of a particular substation. Then you don't have any option. So you have to buy from them only. So then it becomes a monopoly condition. Oligopoly is when you have few sellers. Like you may be okay with any 400 kV voltage data. You are okay with any substation. So then it becomes a oligopoly conditions. So this actually defines the price of the parameter. So one interesting thing is frequency. Frequency is same in throughout the grid, but due to the accuracy of the measurement devices, the values may not be same. So this becomes a monopolistic competition. Like when you have many sellers for same frequency, but it's a differentiated products, means all will have a little difference in their values. So pricing strategy is you can price data using either step, like you price them as a batch, like for 2 days data this much price, or unit brace, for each unit you price it, or flat fee, means you just tell that you use the data, this is the price, irrespective of how much data they are using. Two-part tariff is you basically fix an amount and then you charge per unit basis. Freemium is basically you allow a free access to a limited amount of data, then you give, then somebody has to pay for the premium access. And reverse pricing is when, say, buyer dictates the price of the data. Okay. So pricing attributes is, when you are pricing it, what you should keep in mind, like pricing objective, whether you want to profit or you just want to give it for research, like impact of the data. If the data is important for a particular application, like for energy market, if it is, so it will have much more price. Then cost of metering infrastructure, like through the infrastructure through which it is generating the data. If it is costly, then data also become costly. Then age of data, old data may not cost much. Volume, high volume will increase the cost. Duration of access, if you access for longer time, it will be costly. Accurate data will be costly. Then you, if the database has a lot of errors, then the cost may be less. Then data collection cost, if somebody has to go and collect the data, that will involve cost. And arbitrage free pricing, this is interesting, is like arbitrage free means when you are, suppose you have set a price for a data, but if somebody somehow can get the answer to that query using less money. So that is called arbitrage free data pricing. So arbitrage free data pricing, arbitrage has many subgroups. One of them is post processing arbitrage. That means suppose you have two queries and one answer to one query is costly, answer to other query is comparatively cheaper. Now what you can do is you can use the answer of cheaper query to deduce the answer of costly query. Okay. So that is called post-processing arbitrage. So in case of smart grid, we have identified three such possibilities: parameter arbitrage, locational arbitrage, and data type arbitrage. Parameter is, in electricity, is basically it's governed by network equation, right? So voltage at any bus is governed by impedance and current. Now suppose voltage information is very costly. Now somehow the current information is less costly. So somebody can buy current information or an impedance information, and from that they can deduce the voltage information. So here they can bypass paying higher money to voltages. Okay. Similarly, location. So as again it is an interconnected network, you can use measurements from one location to estimate measurements from other locations. Okay. So buyers can buy data for those substations who cost less and use that data to estimate the data of expensive substations. And the last is data type arbitrage. Means suppose they want, somebody wants information about electrical data. Can they estimate that information or deduce that information from financial or meteorological data? One such example is, suppose you have a smart meter. So from smart meter energy, suppose somebody wants to know the energy bill paid by the, like if buyer needs energy consumption information, so they are looking for electrical data. What he does is he looks at the energy bill, the money the person is paying. So from that financial data, he tries to estimate what is the energy consumption. So this was, so now what are the challenges? One obvious challenge is privacy. So especially in the context of smart meter data, so this is one thing needs to be addressed, but from the regulatory point of view, and also regulations needs to be done, like who should get access, who can buy from a data market, because this is a sensitive information of a country. Now if an enemy country buys your information, it can be a threat. So from regulation and privacy, there has to be some problems has to be solved. Well done. So the conclusion is, so in this work mostly we are talking about smart grid data as a tradable commodity. So it can be a revenue model for a utility. And this is an alternate way of exchanging data between various interested parties. Okay. And this is, we just started this work. So there is further research is needed to take it further. So whatever I just discussed was from a conference paper which we published last year. Thank you.
Sir, what is the current model with which they are handling the data, and why can't we make it free for all?
See, free for all, it's a market decides. So in a market, data can be a free product, it can be a price also. It depends on the seller who wants to sell it. Now you can say that forcefully everything should be free. That is an alternate approach. Market is an approach where market decides what is the price. So here we are talking about that alternate approach, where you don't force and tell everything is free. Here, let market decide. In the market, there can be free products. Standards regarding the formatting or so there are multiple formatting, like one is called SIM, Common Information Model. There is also another formatting for transient data, they call it COMTRAD. So there are standardized formats for these data. These are international standards. This is by IEC and IEEE mostly. Financial market, that data and this data, to some extent, they have a different, so there will be commonality, like some basic work we have taken from the existing data market, which talks about financial data. So that was the groundwork. Then we are now trying to see that for specific to power systems, what is different, what can be.
Are there any portals where you get data?
Free data, that's the thing. Free data, like nobody wants to give data just like that. Now there are few portals worldwide, they give the data, but that data is not good quality. There are few, so I can send you the link. Regulations for which aspect? Regulations regarding like, not much regulations, mostly data privacy, there are regulations. And data market in power system, there is nothing.
Privacy,
No, no, privacy is regarding the general data privacy, not related to electrical data. It's a general data privacy, like Europe recently, they have passed one rule on the data privacy. So it's a general.
So currently, who are the, what is the motivation for buying? Currently in our country, what may be the motivation?
Motivation is equipment manufacturers. So mostly when they design any equipment, they design it to some extent blindly. They can optimize this design. Then energy markets. In energy market, people bid. So while bidding, if you have information about other areas or systems, you can optimize your bidding. Then another thing, when you are studying, like we are divided our power system into small zones. Like we have BESCOM. Now when BESCOM is doing some study for their system, they need information about other systems also, because they are also interconnected. They influence this system. But BESCOM may not have access to network parameters of other systems. So they can purchase it from online and use that.